Thank you. name is higher, one name is stronger than any grave, than any bone. Christ exalted over all. From the grave where death would die, you rose again and brought us life. You're reigning now, the Savior.
We began a subject last week that is, it depends on what background you come from. Is baptism required for salvation? Because so many will tell you yes. Yes, indeed. If you've not been baptized, you will not go to heaven. And we are so bad as Baptists. We think we know what we believe, but we really can't back it up most of the time. So we started unpacking that question last week, and we got so far, and we want to finish that up today. Let me show you a card that's going to be a great help to you this morning. In the back of the pew in front of you, there's a card. It's got a QR code at the top. If you will take your camera on your phone and go, let this card take you. It will take you to the outline that I'll be teaching from. It'll take you to all of the verses that we'll be reading. We'll have those verses up on the screen as well. You're welcome to follow along in your own scriptures as well. It will also take you to a card, and it just says Connect Card on it. And it's the opportunity for those of you that are our guests today. Well, we've got a lot of families that are visiting with us. And would you just, it asks for a name and an email address. That's all I need. I just want to be able to jot you a note tomorrow and thank you for being a part of our worship. All right? Let me just go back and touch on what we taught on last week. And if you missed last week and some of these first two questions really just kind of, I need to know more about this question and how you answered this, then you need to go to our website and you can watch and listen to how we unpacked the whole thing last week. But we were talking about baptism, and I started out with a trick question. I never do that. But I started out with a trick question, and I asked people, when did baptism begin? And just about everybody in here said, with John the Baptist. And the answer was not right. It didn't start with John the Baptist. Baptism was part of Jewish life, Jewish worship, and Jewish culture for many, many centuries and generations. It's part of a cleansing. And where we refer to this pool as a baptistry, they would refer to these pools. And when you go to Israel with us, every town we go in, you will find these pools. They're called mikvahs, but that is their baptism, their cleansing, and they were cleansed before they would go into worship. And so it had been a rite and a ritual for a long, long, long time. When John came along, he offered a baptism of repentance. And it was the people's way of saying, I need repentance in my life. I need to get my life right with God. And so John was in the wilderness calling people to repent. And that was the baptism that he was offering there in the wilderness. And then after the death and the burial, the resurrection of the Lord, when the church began there on Pentecost, baptism became a public declaration. It was a way to let the whole town, your family, all your friends, the people you worked with, the people that lived around you know the surrender that you had made to Jesus as your Messiah. And everybody who was a believer, everybody who had placed their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ was baptized. There was no such thing as an unbaptized believer. They could not wait to make that public. They could not wait to let everybody see them and let everybody know that this is real in my life. I have surrendered. Jesus is my Messiah. Oh boy, that's a little different in the church today, isn't it? You know, baptism, adults, kids will get baptized as soon as they get saved. But adults, oh, we try to put it off and we make excuses. And, well, I don't want to get up in front of everybody. I don't want everybody watching me. But boy, how different it was. They were so proud of who they had given their life to. Well, as the time went on, you know how churches get and how writers get. Everybody's got their own opinion. And this writer came out and he says, well, you know, I really think that baptism means this. I know what the Bible says, but I really think this is what God was meaning. And so this church started doing it this way. And this group said, well, I believe it means this. And everybody had their own way and their own thinking and their own writers and their own opinion. And so what we've ended up in today's world, well, I don't think it's a spiritual word. You could say we've ended up with a mess. And that would probably be a good way of describing it. But we've got such a spectrum of opinions as to what baptism really is. And so this is where we started last week. We answered the first question. First question was this. Tell me, is baptism required for salvation? I mean, can I go to heaven if I've not been baptized? What if even I've surrendered my life to Jesus? I've got friends that go to this church over here or this church over here. And even though I've given my life to Jesus, they're telling me that I'm still not going to heaven because I've not been baptized. You've got another group over here that's saying, well, not only were you not baptized yet, but you weren't baptized in the right church. Right? Because it's only this church that their baptism counts. This one doesn't. And oh, you're so confused and you wonder why people aren't sure whether they're saved or not. You wonder why people question and doubt. You wonder why it's so easy for Satan to confuse believers and get us so turned around that we really aren't sure what we believe. Well, here's the verse, and we expanded this for a long time last week, and I gave you a lot of of concrete to stand on. But we started off with this verse in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. It says, "For by grace." If you're following along in your scriptures and you can underline, what a great phrase that is to underline. "For by grace, you've been saved through faith." By grace, through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift. If I've got to do something in order for you to give me a gift, it's not really a gift, is it? I've earned it, right? And it says, "That not of yourselves." It's a gift from God. Verse 9, "Not of works, not because of anything extra that I've done, lest anyone should boast." Go back to verse 8. "It's by grace alone, through faith alone, plus nothing." It's not plus baptism. It's not plus the involvement of any person in Jesus' family. And we'll get into that on another week. But it is totally by grace. Grace is when God gives us something that we don't deserve. You know what we don't deserve? We don't deserve to be saved. We were sinners. We inherited a sinful nature at conception, and we are sinners. We're separated from God, and we don't deserve for God to give us His forgiveness. We don't deserve for God to say, "I want to forgive you. I want to make you part of my family. I want you to be saved and spend eternity in heaven with me." There's not a person in this building, in this community, in the world that deserves to be forgiven. But yet God said, "Let me give you something that you don't deserve, and I want it to be a gift." You can't do anything to work for it. You can't buy it. You can't earn it. It's simply a gift because of my grace. I want to give you something you don't deserve, and that is forgiveness and salvation. By grace alone, through faith alone. Here's the bottom line. This is where we ended up with after we discussed this for a while. We said this: if I've got to do something else to earn salvation, if you're saying that I have to be baptized in order to go to heaven, in order to be saved, then what you're really saying is Jesus' death on that cross and His resurrection 3 days later wasn't enough. There's more that I've got to do. And it's me doing it, and it's not really a gift from God. You see, when you make baptism a requirement, you have really created, you've created an issue here. That is not salvation, all right? By grace alone, through faith alone. Do you have to be baptized in order to go to heaven? No. Baptism is a step of obedience, but it's not a requirement for faith. And we answered a second question. Well, then who needs to be baptized? Now, there are some people that think that everybody needs to be baptized. If I will just be baptized... You know, in whatever church, in whatever way, if I will just be baptized, then I will go to heaven. And it's for everybody. It's for believers. It's for non-believers. It's even for infants, right? Who should be baptized? Well, we centered around a lot of verses, but I'm just going to use one today just to kind of remind you of where we were last week. In Acts chapter 2, verse 41, this is on the day of Pentecost. This is when the crucifixion has taken place, the resurrection has taken place. Jesus has walked on this earth and has ascended back up into heaven. And now the Holy Spirit has come to start the church. And Peter, on the day of Pentecost, big festival there in Jerusalem. Matter of fact, this year when we go to Jerusalem, we'll be in Jerusalem on Pentecost, June the 5th. And so, boy, what a huge celebration it is there in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. And Jerusalem was packed with people, and the Holy Spirit allowed Peter and the other disciples to begin to share the gospel in each person's native language. And so Peter is speaking in one language and they're speaking in another. Everybody's hearing the same gospel. And this is verse 41. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized. Now, who are those? Then those were baptized. Well, it tells you exactly who it was. It was the ones that received his word, the ones that listened, the ones that understood, the ones that surrendered their life to Almighty God, who received his word about Jesus Christ being God in the flesh, that Jesus Christ came as our Messiah. He was sinless. He was holy. He was killed on that cross, and his blood, his death on that cross, paid the penalty and made available our forgiveness. To those that said, that's what I want. I want to give God my life. I want to be forgiven. I want to be part of God's family. To those who were saved that day, they were the ones that were baptized. This is one of the verses, and this is where we get our teaching that's known as believers' baptism. It's not for everybody. It's only for believers. And I remember the illustration I gave. Now listen, I nearly took my finger off trying to get my wedding ring off last week, so I'm not going to do it again. But if I took that wedding ring off, that wedding ring's a symbol of the commitment that I made to Jamie 47 years ago, right? And I'm just as married without it on as if I had it on. It would be absolutely meaningless if I put it on when I was 10, right? Who am I married to at 10? Nobody. But right now, this is a symbol of the commitment that I made in my heart and in my life to Jamie. That's what baptism is all about. It's a symbol of your surrender, your new life. Those are the people that were baptized. For somebody who's not a believer to get up here and get in the water and say, "Woo, I'm baptized." Well, no, you're not. You're just real wet, right? Should have taken some soap up there, take you a floaty up there, call it a pool, whatever. But there's a world of difference. Baptism is a symbol of the surrender that's taken place in my life. It's believer's baptism. It's meaningless if it was before your salvation. And I shared my own story. I was immersed, not baptized, but I was immersed in a church when I was in third grade, right? So that I could join the church. But I wasn't saved until I was 18. Right before graduation, I gave my life to Christ. And then I began to learn what baptism really meant, and that it was a symbol of my surrender, and that it's absolutely meaningless before salvation. And it wasn't until I was 23 that I learned that, and that's when I was baptized for real. I was in seminary, church I was working in. It blows your mind when the staff member goes down at the invitation. Right? Kind of shakes up some people. Oh, what's he doing down there? And so Brother Bobby baptized me. I said, "Brother Bobby, I've never been baptized. I was immersed when I was 9, but I didn't get saved until I was 18. And I need you to baptize me." And that night, you know what? Was I embarrassed? No. Was there shame? No. I was so excited to let my whole church see me put that wedding symbol on, that symbol of ownership. I belong to Almighty God. Man, I wish it was such that you got baptized every Sunday. Wouldn't that be fun? I just wish it would be like that. What a privilege it is to identify with your Savior. Wow. So that's what believers' baptism is all about. I want to answer two more questions for you today as we wrap up our study on baptism. Number one, people ask this all the time. When I listen and we're talking about baptism, and I get a little bit of what you're saying, but part of it absolutely makes no sense whatsoever. Why did Jesus get baptized? I thought he was God. Well, he is. He still is Almighty God. Well, why did he get baptized? Well, let me answer that for you today. And that's going to kind of set the table for our last question that we're going to deal with. Let's go to John the Baptist out in the wilderness in chapter 3 of Matthew, verse 11. And let's see. This is John talking. John says, "I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I'm not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire." That was John the Baptist talking. And he says, now listen, my baptism, what did he say? First line, "I'm baptizing you with water unto repentance." See, his baptism was so that people could say, "I need to get my life right with God. I need to repent. I need for God to change my life. I need for God to rearrange my priorities. I need for God to be the most important thing in my life. I need to get my life right with God." That's what John's baptism was all about. And people were flooding to John out there in the wilderness, in the Jordan River. And we'll get to go to that place. And you can choose to be baptized in the Jordan River if you'd like to do that when we go in May. You know what? But why did Jesus go? Wait a minute now. If he's Almighty God, if God is holy and sinless and righteous, what has Almighty God got to repent about? It doesn't seem to fit, does it? Teach me. I don't understand this whole deal about Jesus getting baptized. I'm glad you asked that question, because I want to help you understand that. Let's look in four different places here, and I think this will make it come alive. Why did Jesus get baptized? Let's go back into the Old Testament to a prophecy that Isaiah spoke in chapter 40, verse 3. Isaiah said this, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord." Jehovah, Almighty God, "prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God." It is so important. Prophecy is such a huge deal. And prophecy for most believers, now maybe not you, you may be a student of prophecy, but for most believers, and especially believers in a Baptist church, because, you know, it's hard for people just to really get into prophecy. And so, boy, if we offered a class on prophecy, you know, maybe a half a dozen of you would come. It's just a weakness, and I don't understand why. But when God fulfills prophecy, that is huge. And Isaiah said, there's coming a time when there's going to be one who is going to be in the wilderness crying, "Prepare the way, prepare your heart, prepare the hearts of people for the coming of Almighty God," which is referring to John the Baptist. And so when John the Baptist was there in the wilderness, in the Judean wilderness, and he was proclaiming that they needed repentance, that there's coming one after me, that I'm not even worthy. John knew he wasn't worthy. John knew he needed repentance. There's one that's coming after me, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit, with Almighty God. And this is the whole prophecy that was fulfilled with John the Baptist in the wilderness. This was John in the wilderness, and he was saying, this is the one that the prophets wrote about hundreds of years ago. Isaiah wrote that 700 years before Jesus was born. And it was word for word fulfilled when John was baptized and Jesus came to him in the Jordan. He says, behold, the Lamb of God. He introduced Jesus to the world. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. John the Baptist, Jesus coming to John was John's declaration to the world, to all those people that were there. This is the one that they've written about for generations. This is the one that was promised. This is the Messiah that we've been looking for generation after generation after generation. Jesus is the Messiah. It gave John the avenue to declare that to all that were there, as well as fulfill prophecy. God always fulfilled prophecy exactly like He said He would. Let me take you to another passage of Scripture. In Matthew chapter 21, several verses here. Let me read you. Now when He came to the temple, this is talking about Jesus. When He came into the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people confronted Him as He was teaching and said, by what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? This is close to the time of the Passover when Jesus is going to be crucified. All right? He's there on the Temple Mount. He's at the temple and the leaders are confronting Him. Who gave you this authority? Jesus answered and said to them, I will also ask you one thing, and if you tell me, I will likewise tell you by what authority I do these things. I think this is a fabulous passage of Scripture. Jesus ties them up in a knot, and they don't know what to do. He says, listen, what His question is. The baptism of John, where is it from? Was it from heaven or was it from men? What He's asking them is this. Did God in heaven put His stamp of approval on John's baptism, or was John just some lunatic out in the wilderness baptizing people, calling himself a prophet? Where did this come from? Is this from God, this baptism of John, this baptism of repentance? Or was this just made up? And they reasoned among themselves, saying, wait a minute now, if we say from heaven, then He's going to say to us, well, why didn't you believe Him? See, they're walking through the possible answers here. And He says, but if we say from men, we fear the multitude, for all count John as a prophet. Man, we're stuck. If we answer this way, well, then why didn't we obey God? If we answer this way, we're going to be in a lot of trouble. The people are going to mob us because they look at John as a mighty prophet. What are we going to do? They're stuck. So they answered Jesus and said, we don't know. How about that? We don't know. And He said to them, okay, then I won't tell you by what authority I do these things. Isn't that amazing? Later in Jesus' ministry, John's authority was questioned. The whole authority to baptize in the name of Almighty God was in question. And Jesus, being baptized by John, put His stamp of approval on what John was doing. Because if it wasn't of God, why would Jesus have participated in that? Why would Almighty God in the flesh have been part of that had this just been some maniac standing out there in the Jordan River doing these things? But it was His stamp of approval. It was saying that the Father initiated all of this, and baptism is from Almighty God. Now let's look at a third thing. in Romans. Paul wrote in Romans chapter 6 and verse 4. Look at what Paul said. Therefore, we. Who was he writing to? Romans was written to who? Believers or unbelievers? Believers in Rome. So the we believers. Therefore, we believers were buried with him through baptism into death. Symbolically, this is the way your baptism symbolizes burial, death and burial, baptism unto death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. Baptism is a beautiful picture, and it's a beautiful symbol of two things. Number one, it's the symbol of what Jesus did to make salvation available for you and for me. Forgiveness available. He gave His life on that cross. He became our substitute. He became our sacrifice. Somebody, remember we studied this? Somebody's got to pay the penalty for your sin and for my sin. And Jesus said, I will pay the penalty on the cross, and I'm going to make forgiveness available to you. And it's the picture of Him dying on that cross. And they buried Him, not under the ground, but they buried in tombs back then. And He was raised to walk a brand new life 3 days later when He was raised from the dead. That's a picture of the price that He paid for my forgiveness. And the price that He paid to make salvation available to every person here. But it's also a picture of something else. It's not only a picture of what He did for me, but it's a picture of my life when I surrender my life to Him. Because Scripture says that I'm buried with Him. When I surrender my life to God, my old life, the old Steve, Steve before salvation is now dead. The old self, the old Steve is gone, is buried, and I've been given a brand new life. That's the whole symbolism of baptism. Oh, I'm buried with Him by baptism unto death, and I'm raised to walk a brand new life. If you remember, when you've seen me baptized, that's the exact verse that I quote when I baptize. I love it. We're buried with Him by baptism unto death, and we're raised to walk a brand new life. What a beautiful picture baptism is of the salvation that's available to us and the picture of a person who surrendered their life. Let me give you one more verse. Verse 16, when He, Jesus, had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to Him, and He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon Him. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." These two verses are probably familiar if you've been studying with us for the past 2 weeks, because here is one of those instances where you see all three members of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, all together, all evident, all obvious at the very same time. They're not a third of a God and third of a God and third of a God, and you put them together and you've got one God. They're all, each individually, completely and totally Almighty God. It's one God who appears in three different persons, but has one nature. And the Father says from heaven, "This is my Son, and I'm well pleased." It was the Son who was baptized by John. And the Holy Spirit came and descended and was on Jesus like a dove. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all together. What a beautiful picture of Almighty God. Baptism is incredibly important. It was important to God, And it's important to you if you're a believer. And it's very important to me as a believer. And we need to understand that it always is a symbol after I've been saved. Prior to salvation, it absolutely is meaningless. If you've never surrendered your life to Christ, it doesn't matter how many times you've been baptized. It doesn't matter how you've been baptized. You can be sprinkled, dipped, dunked, or poured, and you can be a dozen times each. But if you've never surrendered your life to Christ, you've never experienced Him changing your life, coming to live inside of you, changing your heart, your life, your speech, your relationship, your vocabulary, your goals, your priorities, your values, every part of you. It doesn't matter how many times you've been baptized. If you've never been saved, that's the greatest need that you've got this morning. Let's answer one more question. Okay, does it matter how I'm baptized? Because if you go to this church, well, if you came here, we're going to immerse you. If you go to a church down the street just a little bit, they're going to sprinkle you. If you go a little bit farther, they're going to pour water on your head. If you go a little bit farther, they're going to baptize little babies and infants. Does it matter how I'm baptized? Well, yeah, it really does. It really does. Let me take you to the Great Commission. This is one of the last things recorded in the book of Matthew. And Jesus said these words to the disciples. He said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." Let's play with words just a little bit. I wish our iPad worked and I could write some words out for you. If you've got a pen, you're jotting notes, write this word down. You can go home and Google it, and then you can feel like you really learned something this morning. Here's the word that we get our English word baptized from. Because Scripture was written originally in Greek, the New Testament, Greek and Aramaic. The Greek word here is the word B-A-P. Sound familiar? B-A-P-T-I-Z. Oh, it's getting real close, isn't it? But the Greek verb ends in O. B-I-P-T-I-Z-O, baptizo. And it means to baptize, right? What did that word mean? That word, baptizo, literally meant to submerge in water. If you were washing dishes, you took the dirty plates, and what did you do? You baptizoed the plates and the cups down in your pan of water. You put them under the water. It's most commonly used at the blacksmith shop. You know, you've seen, you know, I've never been to one, but in the Western movies when they're doing the horseshoes and everything, you know, he's got the horseshoe there and the fire and that metal is so hot and they pound on it. He gets it just right. And then what does that blacksmith do to harden that horseshoe? He sticks it down in the water, right? You know what he's doing? He's baptizoing that horseshoe. He's submerging that horseshoe in water. And that is the very term, the exact word that Jesus used for baptize. And so it really does. It's hard when the whole concept of baptism is immersion, to understand how a few drops of water on somebody's head is the same thing as immersion. Now, little boys, when you tell them to go take a bath, now that's how they take a bath sometimes, right? They get their hands in the water, sprinkle water on them, and they tell their mother they've been in the bathtub. But that's not spiritual, and that's not baptism, but that's what a church became known for, right? And then even pouring water on the top of the head of infants. How is pouring water on the top of somebody's head submerging them in water? See, it's a contradiction of terms when to baptize means to totally submerge, and you do something a lot less, is that baptism? Because your action is totally opposite of the definition of the word, right? In the third century, infant baptism became very popular. And it became instituted in the third century. And our Catholic friends started saying, you know what? They were adding baptism to surrender. Well, what about little babies? Now, they can't make a surrender on their own. What if they were to die because the death rate, the infant mortality rate was so high? We've got to do something to make sure that these little babies are going to go to heaven. So we need to start baptizing little babies. And they believe that that infant baptism would take away that little baby's original sin. Oh, this is what's written in their beliefs. But we can't submerge a little baby. So they started sprinkling, and then more churches adopted that, and it became a tradition. And in 1311, the Catholic Church made it official that that was an official mode of baptism for them. And so sprinkling became widely popular, and so many churches moved from immersion to sprinkling. And that's where we end up with today. And we've got such a diverse group in here this morning. If we had the time for every person in here to talk about the background, the religious background that you grew up in and that you came from, it would blow your mind how many different backgrounds and denominations and churches that we have. And we've got people that have been baptized that aren't even believers. You've got people sitting here all throughout our crowd who were baptized before they ever gave their life to Christ like I was. You've got people that were sprinkled that they don't want to get baptized because of embarrassment and pride. Folks, what a spectrum we've got. Oh, but it all comes down to what does God say? Hey, listen, we baptize after church on Sunday mornings, after the second service. And people, we started this with COVID. We used to do it in the middle of our services. And because of COVID, when we couldn't meet, we started doing it family by family. And now people are asking for it that way. Is baptism important? Yes. It's important that it's been done after you've been saved. It's a step of obedience. It's not a requirement for salvation, but it's a step of obedience because I have been saved. And it's really important that it be done scripturally by immersion. You know what? I wonder how many people are here today. Don't raise your hand. And you'd say, you know what? Baptism is not really the biggest need in my life. I've never given my life to Christ. I need to be saved this morning. I wonder how many of you, if I ask you to raise your hand, would be honest and raise your hand. I wonder how many of you would say, you know what, I'm a believer. I've given my life to Christ, but my baptism came before my salvation, and now I need believer's baptism. I need to get my baptism and my salvation in the right order. And I wonder how many would raise their hand and say, you know what, I need to get my baptism in the right order. And I wonder how many of you may have been christened as a baby, may have been baptized by another church in another way. You've never been immersed like Jesus said to be baptized. And you would say, you know what, I need to be baptized by immersion. I wonder how many of you would have raised your hand this morning on one of those things? Listen, we're going to pray. I'm going to give you an opportunity to respond in just a moment. I want you to ask the Lord, Father, what do you want me to do this morning? What do you want me to do? What if I'm sitting there, I know I'm saved, I know I've been baptized. What's in it for me this morning? And the question is this, then who can you tell? Who can you bring that needs to hear about Jesus and hear how to be saved? Father, we love you today. God, what a privilege and an honor it is to be your children. God, I thank you for everybody in here that has given their life to you. Father, I want to pray for those that have never followed you in believer's baptism. God, that you have spoken to their heart this morning and you have impressed them. I need to get my baptism and my salvation in the right order. And I need to be baptized because I was baptized before I was saved. Father, I'm praying for the people that are here who are believers and they were baptized by another method other than immersion. And they're saying, you know what? I need to be immersed. I want to be baptized exactly like Jesus was. Father, I pray most of all for the people that are here this morning that have never given their life to you. The issue in their life is not baptism, but forgiveness and salvation. And I pray this morning that they are saying right now, God, I need you to come into my life. God, I want to give you my heart and my life. Father, would you forgive me of my sins? God, would you be my Savior? Would you come and live inside of me? Father, I pray that we're obeying you this morning. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen.